Hey, it's Michael J. And today I'm going to talk to you about the great Hollywood costume designer, Gilbert Adrian.
Adrian, Hollywood's foremost studio designer, who creates the styles for the stars of Metro-Goldwyn-Mayer, probably has done more to influence style trends the world over.
Gilbert Adrian was MGM's major costume designer from 1928 to 1941. He was in charge of the entire wardrobe department and designed over 250 films. He had a bigger-than-life whimsical aesthetic. He created fantasies on screen, and yet, many of his costumes translated into fashions sold in retail stores as fans of the stars he dressed clamored to wear the beautiful garments they saw in the movies. He was born Adrian Adolph Greenberg in Connecticut in 1903. Adrian's parents were milliners, and so he had a connection to fashion from the beginning. He studied at the Parsons School of Fine and Applied Arts in New York and later in Paris, and designed costumes for summer stock along the way. Producer Florence Cunningham suggested that Greenberg was a poor name for a designer and that he should simply go by his first name. To appease his parents, Adrian took his father's name and became Gilbert Adrian, though he was most often credited in the movies as simply Adrian. By the 1920s, Adrian was designing for Irving Berlin's Music Box Reviews, which brought him to the attention of silent film creator Natasha Rambova, the wife of Rudolph Valentino. A move to Hollywood and Paramount Pictures resulted in Adrian's first film, Cobra, starring Valentino. An offer to design for Cecil B. DeMille took Adrian away from Paramount and landed him at MGM when the DeMille studio folded and the legendary director took up residence at Metro in 1928. He was in the right place at the right time, as a series of resignations, including one from Erte, opened up the opportunity for Adrian to run the MGM wardrobe department.
Well, why don't you go out and get something to do? I ain't stopping you.
You bet you ain't. You think I sat home all day looking at bracelets, ha!
Adrian purposely pushed the boundaries of taste with Jean Harlow's character in Dinner at Eight to enhance her characterization of the common girl who married for money. She could afford anything, so she did everything to the extreme. The press latched onto Harlow's look as the quintessential Hollywood style, which to this day signifies 1930s Hollywood to most.
I was reading a book the other day.
Reading a book?
Yes, it's all about civilization or something. A nutty kind of a book. Do you know that the guy says that machinery is going to take the place of every profession?
Oh, my dear. That's something you need never worry about.
I'm a completely worthless woman, and no man should risk his life for me. For that reason alone, I beg you leave this place at once.
I will.
Adrian didn't adhere to period authenticity when designing a costume drama. He liked to take the period styles and make them larger than life.
I accepted her favors because I thought she loved me. I let her make sacrifices for me when there were others who had more to give. But bear witness, I owe her nothing. Take it. Go on, take it! Buy camellias, buy diamonds, horses and carriages, buy moonlight, buy a grave! I congratulate you, Miss.
Notice the garnish on the dress of this character popping in through the door. Another great example of exaggerating the period, Norma Scherer in Marie Antoinette. MGM did everything big. A completely remade Norma Scherer with Clark Gable in Idiot's Delight.
This will be amusing, Gatil.
I hope so.
I saw through you from the very beginning.
And you adore me, don't you, darling?
Did I ever say so?
No, of course not. You must never admit it. You must never change that funny character.
Adrian's background with Broadway reviews couldn't help but enhance his designs for films like The Great Ziegfeld and Ziegfeld Girl, where the Follies was so elaborate it could never have fit onto an actual Broadway stage.
She catches you right from the start.
just like a beautiful melody you play on the strings of your heart.
There were no period details to worry about in The Wizard of Oz. Adrian was completely free to let his imagination run wild. The Munchkins outfits were made of felt and were all designed with a flower motif. The design of the principal characters was based on the familiar illustrations by William Wallace Denslow from the original book.
That's how we laugh the day away in the merry old land of Oz. That's how we laugh the day away.
What is all this?
I've had 2 years to grow claws, Mother. Jungle Rain!
The ultimate Adrian film has to be The Women, a story about a large cast of New York society women, played by MGM's great stable of female stars, was perfect for Adrian's elaborate fashions. Look at those whimsical hats. They completely support the comic tone of the film.
Come on, girls, let's sit down.
She can't take it.
Bonjour, mesdames. Mademoiselle, it gives me great pleasure to be your cicerone on our adventurous little voyage into fashion land.
MGM even went so far as to add in a fantastical fashion show sequence filmed in Technicolor.
Trying to break up my marriage, you cats. But get this straight, Mary Haynes. You can't stampede me by gossip or the drunken ravings of Buck Winston. You've got to have evidence. And Stephen is a gentleman.
He doesn't need that kind of evidence outside New York.
Stephen's fed up with you, Crystal. In your heart, you know it.
Yes, Crystal, take my advice. Put your mind on your alimony.
Alimony? With what Stephen can get on you, he won't have to give you a dime.
Oh, is that so?
Well, what if I don't need alimony? How would you like that?
You don't need alimony. What are you going to use instead of it, sugar?
Buck Winston. Oh!
In 1941, Adrian's contract with MGM came to an end, and he turned his attention to the fashion industry. making an impressive first showing that put his garments in numerous retail outlets. His designs, significantly his use with the broad shoulder and narrow skirt, dominated the look of World War II. In the 1950s, Adrian detached from fashion as Christian Dior's new look took the world by storm. He returned to MGM for one last film, Lovely to Look At, a remake of the Jerome Kern musical Roberta. Adrian had begun working on the costumes for Broadway's Camelot, but suffered a heart attack in 1959 and did not personally complete the assignment, though his work was honored with a Tony Award. Adrian was openly gay to his immediate circle, but in 1939 he married actress Janet Gaynor, most likely due to industry pressures of the time as he became more famous to the public. It may seem surprising to discover that Adrian never won an Academy Award, but there was actually no category for costume design during his reign in Hollywood. Gilbert Adrian's contribution to the films he worked on gave them a distinct identity, and he was also able to directly influence fashion to the greater public beyond Hollywood. When historians refer to old Hollywood as the Dream Factory, part of what they're talking about is the magic provided by Adrian. If you want to learn more about Gilbert Adrian, there isn't a whole lot out there, which is one of the reasons I made this video. But there's a great book by Howard Guttner. It's called Gowns by Adrian. I picked this up at the Metropolitan Museum of Art in New York when they had a show of Adrian's gowns and things from The Wizard of Oz, which was fascinating to see in person. But this is the best book on the market. There's really this and only a few other things that mention him, but this is a good biography and a good retrospective of his work, especially at MGM, and you can still get this on Amazon, I checked. So if you want to learn more, this is your source. And if you'd like to see a video I made about my favorite top 10 costumes in movie history, you can click the link at the end. And also, I've made a small documentary about Edith Head, who's one of my other very favorite costume designers in Hollywood. Thanks for watching.
And so we bid goodbye to Hollywood, style center of the world, as another romance of celluloid comes to a close. Your daily newspapers and the marquee of your favorite theater will herald the showing in your city of the productions you have just seen in preview. And remember always that this big parade of more stars than there are in the heavens is your surest guide to the finest entertainment any theater can offer.